Greetings in that strong and blessed name of Jesus. Welcome to Fully Alive. Fully Alive is an outreach ministry of the Church of God in Cleveland, located at 11100 Union Avenue in Cleveland, Ohio. My name is Pastor Abe Jeter. Well, praise our God, we are studying the book of Luke, and we're on chapter 10, amen. Praise God. Last week, our title of the lesson was The Awful Danger of Sinning Against Light. The awful danger of sinning against light. Amen. And we're studying chapter 10. And so as we started out in that chapter, we just begin to go verse by verse and build upon line upon line. And so we see Jesus sending out 70 disciples, okay? He gave them specific instructions on doing evangelism. Verse 5 says that you're to bless a home when you go into a home. And verse 7 says you're to fellowship with them. You're to listen to them, build bridges, you know, of friendship, learn their felt needs. And that's what we said. That's the way we thoughts that we brought out from verse 7. And then verse 10 said minister to their felt needs, because once you bless the home and begin to eat the things that they set before you, you know, you're fellowshipping with them and you're listening, you find out what their felt needs are, and then you minister to those felt needs, amen? Yes, you heal the sick, he says in verse 10, amen? And then you preach the kingdom of God to them. Obviously, their real needs would be salvation. Their real needs would be a relationship with Jesus, to enter into the kingdom, a kingdom experience, but amen. And so instead of just going to the house and jumping right on them, trying to get them saved, no, bless the house, fellowship with them, and then minister to their felt needs, then preach the kingdom of God. Amen. We found that Jesus sent these 70 out as lambs among wolves. Amen. Praise God. Evangelism could be dangerous business. I looked at that. Amen. Jesus' passion was for the lost. It was the lost that motivated his action. He said that the harvest was great, he said, but laborers few. And he said we need to pray, amen, to the Lord of harvest that he would send forth laborers. Praise God. You know, Jesus' ministry consisted of clear teachings and of revelation truth. Well, praise God. Jesus' ministry was one of mighty signs and wonders. Amen. Jesus' ministry was one of mentoring and empowering others. Praise God. And so he empowered the 12 and sent them out. Amen. He empowered the 70 and sent them out. Praise God. And lastly, he is empowering and equipping and sending out all of us since Pentecost, amen, since the Great Commission, amen. So praise God, he is still empowering us today. Yes, we concluded last week's message focusing on Jesus pronouncing woes on those who saw, who understood, but refused to believe it. I mean, amen. They saw the mighty work that Jesus was doing. And John says, if it was written, he supposed that all the books in the world couldn't contain, amen, to all the miracles that Jesus did. Amen. Praise our God. And so, again, we concluded focusing on Jesus pronouncing woes on those who saw, understood, but refused to believe, refused to repent, refused to give glory to God. Amen. We reminded everyone that there is an awful danger of sinning against light. Amen. Greater men and women than you and I have been deceived and gone into darkness because they sin against light, sin against revelation truth, a truth that the Holy Ghost had revealed to their spirit, based on the word of God. Amen? Yes. Well, praise our God. Jesus, in the midst of his teaching in one place, he says, remember Lot's wife. She sinned against light and was turned into a pillar of salt. Amen. Lot's daughters sinned against light when they had their father impregnate them. Amen. Well, praise our God. Judas Iscariot sinned against light. Amen. As he betrayed Jesus. Amen. And amen. And so we concluded our lesson where Jesus was condemning Capernaum, because Capernaum was his headquarters and mighty works were done there. Amen. And that's why in Luke 10:15, Jesus says, and thou, Capernaum, which are exalted to heaven, shall be thrust down to hell. And he goes on to say, he that heareth you heareth me, and he that despises me, and he that despiseth you despises me, and he that despises me despises him that sent me. And he was speaking, amen, to those 70. Amen. Praise our God. All right, now, and so we want to start the lesson out today with verse 17. We see the return of the 70. He sent those 70 out, amen, gave them specific instructions, and now we see them returning, amen. Verse 17 says, read verse 17 through 20, and it says, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Verse 18, and he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Verse 20, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Praise our God. We just want to unfold that a little bit. Praise our God. And so as the 70 return, amen, the 70 learn much through actual ministry, amen? You know, this is some things you're not going to learn until you actually get out there in the field and do ministry. Well, praise God. The 70, you know, it just came on my mind. It probably doesn't even apply, but I remember sharing the plan of salvation with a number of people, and this one young lady, amen, she learned to share what we call the bridge illustration, and she went out and she shared it with someone, and they gave their hearts to the Lord, and she was so excited. Well, praise God. There's just some things you can't learn unless you get out there and apply. So, you know, God's going to give you some basics, but then when you get out there, you're going to learn a lot more. Praise God. And she came back rejoicing, just like these disciples. And so the Bible says the 70 returned rejoicing. They learned much through actual ministry. Jesus didn't tell them everything, amen? But he told them what they needed to get the job done, amen? And the same thing with you, amen? He's not going to tell you everything. He wants you to get out there and make application. And as you are in ministry, the Spirit of the living God is going to teach you, because you're going to come across situations that you won't know what to do. But the Holy Ghost will tell you at that very time what to do. Well, praise our God. Amen. They came back with joy. Okay? They came back saying, devils are subject to us in thy name. Whoa, well, Jesus didn't tell them that. They must have came across a situation where the devil raised up and they didn't know what to do. And the Holy Ghost says, rebuke that demon in the name of Jesus. And that's what they did. And they found out that it worked. Well, praise our God. Amen. Well, you know, like I said, the Spirit of God will give you insight I remember the first demon that I remember casting out, this woman was sharing with us she was looking through the mirror, and a devil spoke out of her and says, "You're mine, and you've always been mine." And she was freaking out, and she wanted to know from me, did I think she was crazy? And I thought, well, I don't think so. I knew I'd been doing some studying on these kinds of things. And so I began to rebuke the devil based on what I understood about her past. And she said to me, "You know, this devil is laughing at you because that's not him." You know, I was rebuking abuse and all this kind of stuff. And she says, "That demon is laughing at you. That is not the demon." And many times, you know, Jesus identified demons by what they did, you know. And so I thought there was some abuse in the background. And so I began to rebuke that demon of abuse, but that wasn't it. And so I didn't know what to do. And so it came to me that I should pray and ask God, what's the door? Well, you were trying to determine the door that the demon came in. And I learned enough that I knew that I needed to determine the door. How did that demon get in? So we can close that door and cast him out. And so we prayed. And as we prayed, God showed us that in this case, it was an abortion that she had taken, she had gotten involved in and got demonized, okay? And I'm not saying everybody who got an abortion got demonized, but I would certainly be concerned about that aspect, okay? And so this woman certainly was demonized, amen, through when she got that abortion. That gave the devil the legal right to come into her at any point in her case. So once we found that out, then we could then instruct her amen, we need to pray, and so that she can ask God to forgive her for doing that, because we consider that as murder. And so she confessed it as sin, asked God to forgive her for that. And but what she couldn't do is ask, she couldn't forgive herself. And I said, "No, you have to forgive yourself, because if you don't forgive yourself, then that demon still has legal right to stay there." And so we had to pray then. The Holy Ghost directed us to pray. So we prayed again, and we asked God to give her grace to forgive herself. And God did. He gave her the grace to forgive herself. She could receive God's forgiveness, but she couldn't forgive herself. And so God gave her the grace to forgive herself. And so having confessed the sin and forgiven herself and asked God to forgive her, amen, then we were able to close that particular door in the name of Jesus. Once that door was closed, then we took authority in the name of Jesus, and we commanded that demon spirit of abortion to leave her now in Jesus' name, and it did in the name of Jesus. Well, praise our God. And that was the first time, you know, that I knew of that a demon was actually cast out. But nevertheless, praise God. And like these 70, amen, I learn in practice. And that's where you will learn as well. And so Jesus had given them some basics, but they came across circumstances and situations that they had to rely on the Holy Ghost to give them instruction at the time. Well, praise God. And Jesus responded when they said, "Lord, even devils are subject to us in your name." And Jesus made this statement in verse 18. And he said unto them, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven." Amen. Praise our God. He says, "I beheld Satan," he says, "as lightning fall from heaven." Somebody says, what did he mean? What did Jesus mean by that statement? Well, now there's some controversy around that statement, because a lot of people use this particular scripture when they are trying to teach that Satan was kicked out of heaven. Well, and so you know, so there's controversy even about that, about the origin of Satan. You know, my position is that the Bible is not clear about the origin of Satan, amen. But it is clear that he exists, and it is clear that he's defeated. Okay, and so we know that a lot of folks go to various scriptures and teach that Satan was an angel and he got kicked out of heaven. So, and I'm not trying to take that away from you if that's where you are. But I am saying that this scripture right here, I don't believe that's what he's talking about, okay? Well, praise our God. Somebody says, well, what do you think that scripture means? Well, I believe that Satan held a high and lofty position in the hearts and in the minds of people at that time. Amen. Even God's people, okay? The Jews. Amen. The Bible in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, as it refers to Satan, he is called the God of this world. Why? Because people has given him that high and lofty position in their hearts and their minds. Amen. But when the 70 went out ministering truth and casting out devils, Satan lost that high position he held in their lives. And so when the 70 came back, he says, Lord, even devils are subject to us in thy name. Jesus says, I beheld Satan fall from heaven as lightning. Well, amen. He was talking about that high and lofty position that Satan held being cast down. Well, praise our God. Amen. I believe that Jesus was speaking to the immediate situation and not to an event that happened prior to creation of the world in God's heaven, okay? And so, but nevertheless, however you want to approach that, it's not a test of fellowship. Hallelujah. Thing that we want to get settled is that Satan is real and that he's a defeated devil, all right? Well, praise our God, amen? And so, he goes on in verse 19 and makes another powerful statement. He says in verse 19, behold, he says, I give unto you power. And you look up the root of that word, he gives authority, okay? Behold, he says, or as one scripture says, power and authority, okay? And so he says, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and on scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Now, he's talking to believers, okay? So that challenges me to do some teaching on the authority of the believer. Listen, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Put them under your feet, okay? And of all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Well, praise our God. And not only was that applying to the 70, but I believe it applies to us. Amen? Praise our God. I believe we need to lay hold of this scripture, and we need to claim it personally. We need to meditate on it. We need to confess it. Until this scripture, so the truth of this scripture gets deep down our spirit and we're able to exercise that authority. We need to know who we are in Christ Jesus. We need to understand what authority that God has given us. And we need to begin to speak and declare words of faith. Well, praise our God. Listen, the authority that operated in Jesus was passed on to the apostles. Amen. You know, when Jesus spoke, the people went, for he spoke as one that had authority and not as the Pharisees. Yes, authority. And that was that Holy Ghost anointing. That was that Holy Ghost empowering. Okay, listen. Amen. But that authority that operated in Jesus was passed on to the apostles, because the Bible says in Luke chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, then he called his 12 disciples together and he gave them power and authority. And so power here is dunamis and authority, okay? So over all devils and to cure diseases. Praise our God. Now, apparently Jesus didn't tell those 70 that they had power over all devils, but they found out they did. Praise our God. And so in Luke 9:1, then he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and to cure diseases. Verse 2, and he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Amen. Praise that God. So the authority that operated in Jesus operated in the disciples. Hallelujah. Praise God. Listen, now the authority, amen, that operated in Jesus and operated in the disciples, praise God, has been passed to us today. We operate in that same authority today. Praise our God. Now, in Mark chapter 13, verse 34, Mark chapter, 13, verse 34, Jesus said, for the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Listen, for the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, okay? So Jesus took a far journey, okay? Who left his house, the church, okay? The body of Christ, okay? And gave authority to his servants, us, and to every man work. Not only did he give me a work because he has called me and gifted me, but he also gave me authority. Not only did he give you a work to do, because everyone has a work and a gift, okay? But he gave you authority to be able to do that work, amen? Because you got to operate in the authority of Jesus. You got to operate in the name of Jesus, because I guarantee you Satan will oppose you. He will oppose the advancement of the kingdom of God. But you have authority to carry out that work. And so this scripture says, for the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work and commanded the porter to watch, to be a work, to be awake, to be alert. Amen. Well, praise our God. Anyway, the authority that operated in Jesus and the apostles operate in us today. Okay. Matthew 28, 18 through 20. Great commission. Listen. Amen. He said, amen. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Now, if Jesus have all power, how much power does that leave for Satan? It doesn't leave any, okay? All power is given to Jesus Christ in heaven and earth. Now, the Bible teaches us that I put on Christ. For as many of you as been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. So I'm clothed with Christ. So are you. So all power is given to him. I'm in him. I'm clothed with him. I have his righteousness. I have his sonship. Okay. I have his love for the Father. I have his ability to advance the kingdom of God in his name. Okay. Matthew 28:18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Well, praise our God. I operate in the name of Jesus. I put on the name of Jesus. And I've told you this before. We were, me and a friend of mine, we were casting out demons. And I was casting them out. And at one point, it seemed like it wasn't effective as it had been. So we switched. And he began to cast out the demons. Okay. And at one point, he said to the demon, "Do you know who's in back of me? Do you see who's standing behind me?" And the demon spoke out of the person and says, "Yes, I see it." And he says, "Well, who?" And the demon says, "Jesus." Well, my friend said to me, you know, I was really surprised that that demon said that. He said, I know I asked him to say that, but I really didn't expect an answer. He says, but he was right. That demon said Jesus was behind him, because we were casting out demons in the name of Jesus, not in our own strength, not in our own might, in the name of Jesus. Whether it looked like it was working, whether it felt like it was working, we were taking authority in the name of Jesus. And that demon acknowledged that it was Jesus in back of us. Well, praise our God. Amen. And so, amen. So the authority that operated in Jesus was passed on to the disciples. Authority that operated in them were passed on to us today. And so we operate then in the name of Jesus, amen. And Jesus said in Luke 10:19, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you." Well, praise our God. And then he says, look, okay, notwithstanding, verse 20, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. That's what you want to get excited about, that your name is in the book of life. Amen. We sing a song, you know, my name is in the book of life. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. You know, I rise above all worldly strife, and you know, and my name is, I see my name there, it's written clear or something like that. But anyway, amen, I didn't write down the lyrics. But listen, the Bible talks about God having a book of life. And it's important that your name is written in the book of life. In fact, scripture tells us that one day, as we stand in the judgment seat of God, the Bible says that the books were open, and people got a lot of ideas about that. Then the scripture says, it talks about the book of life. It talks about whoever name was not written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. So God has a book, amen? And so maybe next week we might talk a little bit about that book of life. I don't know. Very important subject, a lot of controversy upon it, amen? He says, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are in the book, are written in the, your names are written in heaven, okay? And the Bible teaches that God definitely has a book, okay? In fact, amen, that book is for overcomers. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 5 says, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name, I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before the angels," amen? And so there is a book. Amen. Praise God. Jesus says, get excited that your name is written in that book, the book of life. It is a book for overcomers. Well, praise our God. So we'll see how the Lord directs as we move next week. Amen. If we want to talk about the book of life, amen, or do we want to go on to verse 21? So we'll see. Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord smile on you. The Lord shed his countenance upon you. The Lord give you peace, okay? Fully Alive is a listener-supported ministry, and as we approach the year end, you need to be thinking about sowing some seed through Giblify, through the Church of God of Cleveland, Sidemark, Fully Alive. God bless you.